thanks everybody for joining us today. My name is Nick Biasini. We're here to talk to you about evolving your defense, making heads or tails of threat actor trends. I'll start with a little disclaimer here.
So my name is Pierre Cadieux. I'm the senior manager of the Cisco Talos Incident Response Team. I'm here today to help present some of the actions we recommend taking when we have incidents or preparing for incidents. And back to Nick.
My name is Nick Biasini. I'm a threat researcher. I'm actually head of outreach for Cisco Talos. Been at Talos for about 7 years, in the industry for more than 15. I got my start as a SOC analyst. Over the years, I've been an analyst, lead analyst, managed teams of analysts. I was a threat hunter for a while. Now I manage a team of threat hunters as well. I'm based out of Austin, Texas, and today I'm here to talk to you about where we're at with threat actors, how the environment's changing. I'm going to talk to you about a couple of different things. The main focus will be on the activity that we've seen out of nation states. I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about big game hunting and the ransomware cartels as well, as that's another big sophisticated threat actor group that organizations are facing. And then kind of how the vulnerability landscape has changed considerably in the pandemic. But it's more than that, right? It also includes how our environment and how the threat landscape overall has changed. We're in a world today that is either full remote or hybrid for now or forever. We're not really sure yet. The actors are really starting to focus specifically on trust abuse and figuring out how to use the organizations, the vendors, and the people that you trust against you. And really, the attack surface has increased drastically over the last couple of years for a variety of reasons, pandemic and otherwise. So let's kind of start by talking about, you know, how do we get here? I always like to kind of look backward before I look forward. So if you look historically at nation-state activity, what you largely have is stuff like this: spy versus spy, traditional espionage. It's just they took the traditional espionage activities that nation-states did and they forklifted it into the internet. So let's talk about some examples. The first example I'm going to talk about is Moonlight Maze. It's really old, but it is a great example for how traditional cyber espionage nation state activity worked. This was a very long-running campaign, ran over the course of years. They did use unpatched known vulnerabilities, so end-day vulns, to get access to systems. The targeting was specific around governments, military, and higher education, as you commonly would find amongst nation states at the time. The goal was purely to gather and exfiltrate data. They're not really sure how much data because it was so long running that it's been difficult for them to track the breadth of the compromise. And one of the other interesting techniques that they did is they did use proxies to kind of hide their activity. So it made it look like the activity was coming from another higher education institution or trusted partner as opposed to, say, an actor-controlled server. Now, if you flash forward another 10 or so years, you get another great example, or 10 or 20 years, get a great example of how it's evolved, yet it's kind of stayed the same. If you flash forward to Operation Aurora, you had another advanced actor, but the targeting had changed. Instead of going after, you know, the higher educations, the government, and the military, they're going after private companies. And they're switching from using known vulnerabilities to zero days. In this case, they were leveraging zero days against Internet Explorer and Adobe Reader. One of the other interesting things to point out here is they were deploying custom tools. Historically, that's what we commonly saw. Nation states would write their own RAT, write their own malicious payload, and then deliver it to enterprises. One other thing that we saw was a slight shift in the types of data that we're targeting. They're still going after data. In this case, there was some information about individuals of interest that they were going after, but it also branched out and spread out more into intellectual property and IP. To where what you're seeing is they're not necessarily going after things other than data, just different types of data primarily. We're gonna wait for questions until the end. So that kind of sets the groundwork for where we were. Now let me talk about kind of where we're going and where we're at today. So the topics I'm gonna talk about in the landscape today are gonna be primarily focused around supply chain, both software and services, as both are being widely abused today. How zero days are being exploited at a rate we really haven't seen in recent future, but we are still seeing those end day vulnerabilities playing very big roles in compromise. How mobile targeting, we probably spent 15 years talking about how mobile targeting would be a huge, huge part of this. But over the last couple of years, it's really started to build momentum and become a bigger and bigger part of the landscape and how kind of exploit availability has changed. 5 or 10 years ago, there was only a handful of actors in the space. Today, you have 15, 20, 30, every major country out there has some sort of offensive capability. And instead of having to develop all those exploits in-house, they're able to buy them. So anybody with deep pockets has the ability to launch very sophisticated attacks today. So let's start with software supply chain. It's been attacked widely over the last five or so years, but the place that I want to start is with NotPetya. This was 2016 timeframe. Was a nation-state actor. It's since been attributed to Russia. There's a couple of things that I'm going to call out. First and foremost, it was a software supply chain attack. It was targeting a tax software company in Ukraine. One of the other things that I always like to call out is the fact that it was a destructive attack, masquerading as a ransomware attack. This is one of the first instances we saw of a very widespread campaign focused primarily on inflicting damage, something that we're going to see replayed time and time again as time goes on. The other thing that's interesting is the way that it went about compromising these systems. It kind of hit both the past and the future of how nation states would operate. They used exploitation, so they had Eternal Blue and Eternal Romance in there. So active exploitation played a role, but they did also use WMI and PSExec to move laterally inside the environment. And what we see more and more is this move away from using active exploitation, especially when you're already on the system, to more of a use of lull bins or living off the land binaries, using the tools that are already on the systems to further their malicious campaigns. So flash forward another few months, actually, at this point, and we had another big example of a software supply chain attack. This one is important for a couple of different reasons. First and foremost, it kind of showed the pathway for the fact that all software supply chain attacks aren't necessarily created equal, right? They're extremely effective, but it's dependent on the level of access of the systems and the users that you're compromising. So with CCleaner, we saw adversaries start going after system administration tools or power tools, things that if you compromise that the users that are using them are likely going to already have a very increased level of access. Additionally, it really shows the breadth of the adversary that you're facing. CCleaner at the time was owned by a company called Avast. During the compromise, they said that the compromised version of CCleaner was downloaded more than 3 million times. But in their research, they only could find 50 victim systems that received additional payloads. This is an adversary that's willing to compromise more than 3 million systems to just get a foothold into 50. This gives you a really clear idea of the challenges that we face as enterprises from these types of sophisticated actors. So that's kind of where we are, where we were, and a little bit on supply chain, but the targeting has continued to shift over time. One of the best examples of that was Olympic Destroyer. What made this interesting is, yes, it was another destructive attack, but it was also designed to be extremely public. Historically, that's not how nation states operated. Everything was meant to be covert, not designed to be done in the public eye. And this was one of the best examples of an attack that was specifically done to drive public attention. One of the other things that's super important about Olympic Destroyer is the fact that they put false flags into the activity. So over the course of the 6 months after Olympic Destroyer happened, it was attributed to multiple different nations because of the fact that they added things to throw off attribution. This is something that we're going to see repeated time and time again. And as nation states have kind of coalesced around the use of lull bins and living off the land more and more or using commodity tools, it's getting easier and easier for them to try to cloud the attribution around who's actually doing the activity. The other thing that's interesting about this is it starts to show the importance of credentials. This particular malware, the way it operated is it would destroy systems, but before it did it, it would gather credentials and then hot patch those credentials into the binary. So in real time, they were taking the credentials that they were gathering and using it to further the spread of the attack. Again, credentials are becoming more and more of an importance as time goes on. It's not just that type of an escalation, right? We've now seen this move with VPN filter and Cyclops Blink, where adversaries are starting to target different types of equipment. You know, for the longest time, it was I'm a target at the office. I need to protect my resources at the office. VPN Filter and Cyclops Blink were specifically designed to compromise your router at home. So why would adversaries do that? First and foremost, it is incredibly difficult to detect an attack on your home network, on your home networking device. I mean, a lot of people today have a combination modem and router. How are you going to put detection capabilities on the other side of that to be able to see the attack? But more so than that, the access that they have provides them a very important foothold. They can now analyze all the traffic moving in and out of the network. They can inject active exploitation into that. More concerningly, they can use that access as a foothold for different attacks. So as defenders, how do you differentiate from a home user that's at their home house that's logging in with their credentials and an actor that's sitting on the router at their home that's also using their credentials to log in? It is an incredibly, incredibly difficult challenge to face and really starts to explain why we're seeing more and more this type of behavior. At this point for enterprises, you should start treating home Wi-Fi like you would public Wi-Fi. Because in honesty, there's no difference today between the network at your house and the network you're connecting to it at the local coffee shop with attacks like this. Now, one of the things that we've seen repeatedly happening in Ukraine is this use of wipers. I've talked multiple times already about this repeated use of wiping activity and destructive malware. The thing that I want to call out about this is these adversaries are doing this in a very methodical way. So they released three or four different waves of wipers, which is not that unexpected. But what is unexpected is the fact that they took completely different methodologies each time they did it. So they would launch one wiper that would go after actually wiping data on the disk. So you would have a bunch of defensive measures that would be put in place to handle programs that are going to wipe data off disk. So what do? They come out with a different wiper attack that doesn't touch the data on the disk at all and goes specifically after metadata. So again, you build protections get built to handle wipers that are attacking metadata, and then they release another wiper that instead is going after the file system. This is a very methodical and effective approach to inflict maximum amounts of damage, despite the fact that you know that defensive measures are going to be put in place along the way. The use of destructive malware is becoming incredibly common and will likely continue for the foreseeable future. So I've kind of talked about the technological stuff. Let me talk a little more about how I've started to see nation states escalate their activities for the worse. The biggest example I'm going to use is Sea Turtle. So Sea Turtle is a service-based supply chain attack. However, what makes this most interesting is they targeted one of the foundations of the internet. They were going after DNS. They weren't just going after DNS. They were hacking registrants. They were modifying DNS records, hijacking DNS servers, making it so that they were able to have the legitimate domains resolved to their IPs. Now, in this particular instance, nothing really bad happened. Unintended, obviously. It's a malicious attack, so there's malicious impact. But my fear is that nation states love to copy one another, right? And someone launching an attack on DNS successfully may green light some other, maybe less sophisticated nation state or less careful nation state to undertake this type of attack. My fear is in 5 or 10 years, we're going to look back and realize that Sea Turtle was an event that we should have paid a lot more attention to, because there is a very real possibility that nation states could do something that would greatly impact one of the foundations of the internet, causing a lot of unintended consequences, something that unfortunately we've seen time and time again, just like in NotPetya, in something that was supposed to be a localized attack, caused ripples all around the globe. Now, the other major one that everybody, I'm sure, is more than familiar with is SolarWinds. This also is a software supply chain attack. Does also point to the fact that the adversaries had learned that going after system tools or monitoring tools are a good avenue to do this. But I'm going to talk about a different aspect of this. I'm talking about what they were targeting. So the goals of this was SAML tokens. Why are actors targeting SAML tokens? So there's a couple of reasons. First and foremost, environments today are hybrid, right? You don't have very many organizations that are completely on-prem or completely in cloud. So SAML tokens give you the ability to detect or to access both on-prem and cloud solutions. The other thing it lets you do is bypass MFA. So what does that tell you? It tells you that MFA works, that adversaries do not like it, and it does actually slow down their progression, which is one of the reasons why we continue to see them go after this trust and try and abuse their trust to gain access to resources. Okay, so Hafnium and the exchange vulnerabilities. So the thing I want to call out about this is not so much the vulnerability, but it's the process and what happened. So what you had was a series of vulnerabilities in exchange that were used in highly targeted attacks by nation states. Within about 24 to 36 hours, the same information about those vulnerabilities, including POCs, leaked onto the internet, at which point every adversary on the planet began attacking heavily. If whether that was an intentional thing or not doesn't really matter, because next time it will be. What it showed them is when you start having a huge amount of actors targeting this exploit, now defenders are fighting off 10, 15 people in the environment, and it makes it much more difficult to detect that really sophisticated nation state, the one that's doing the very targeted attack, that's doing a lot of damage. You now have all this noise to fight and overwhelm. And honestly, if I were a nation state in this space, this is the type of methodology I would use. If I'm gonna use a zero day and I wanna get the most value out of it, leaking it publicly might be a good way to do it. One last thing I wanna talk to you about, ransomware cartels. I said before I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about them. These actors are wreaking havoc on enterprises. The best way that I know to describe them is they're doing unauthorized pen tests on networks all over the planet. Their goal is basically compromise systems through whatever mechanisms possible, you know, active exploitation, phishing, social engineering, anything that they can do to get in. They buy access, whatever they can do to get inside. They have two goals: gather data, exfiltrate it, and then ransom. Some groups do one, some groups do both. It really depends on the individual group, but those are the two primary targets that we see, the activities that we see these groups doing. Now, I wanted to specifically call out Cassia because of how the attack worked. So what you have here is a ransomware cartel that used multiple zero days against a product to compromise an MSP and use it in a services-based supply chain attack. If you would have told me 15 years ago that a criminal organization would use multiple zero days to launch a supply chain attack against customers, I would have laughed. Because it just wasn't in the calculus. We didn't even imagine that this would be where we would be 10, 15 years later, but yet here we are with organizations that are almost funded as well as nation states are today, with huge amounts of revenue and huge amounts of resources. They're able to do attacks that we previously would have only associated with nation states, making all of our lives, unfortunately, a lot more difficult. So again, just to kind of summarize the things that I talked about today, trust is really under attack by nation states. This is what they're going after. The good news is we've gotten better at what we do. That's why they're more and more going after trust. We've gotten good at defending ourselves, but the problem is they're gonna use your partners, your vendors, your employees, whoever they can against you. Anyone that you trust, they're gonna try to use that trust as a mechanism to compromise you. As we've seen more and more of a move to remote work and remote access, it's really increased the attack surface and really has changed the dynamic under what organizations need to look at as hostile networks, right? Basically anything that's not physically owned by the enterprise should be considered hostile, even if it's not at this point. Supply chain is continuing to be a bigger and bigger problem. Honestly, it's not so much, one of my colleagues says a famous thing, it's not so much a chain as it is a web. There are so many parts and pieces to how software is created today, between open source libraries, various vendors exchanging data back and forth, packages being moved between organizations. There are so many avenues for supply chain for adversaries to take advantage of. It's really something that we're gonna have to deal with for the foreseeable future. Again, the fact that exploit markets have really kind of changed the dynamic. What used to be reserved for a small group of nation states that maybe had the expertise to build and weaponize these exploits is now available to any nation with deep pockets. And who knows in the future who will eventually get access to these exploits. There is a very, very large amount of both known and unknown exploits that are available and fully weaponized. One point about critical infrastructure, I haven't really mentioned it yet. We continue to see nation states taking a particular interest in critical infrastructure. But the key thing to point out there is I think that nation states are going to understand and learn from attacks like Colonial Pipeline, in that it's just as effective to attack the IT and you can have just as much impact attacking IT as you do actually attacking the operational tech or the OT. Doing OT attacks is destructive and potentially deadly, whereas doing an attack against IT, you can take down infrastructure, but it's easier to walk back. Nation states are going to be very concerned about doing something that could cause a huge amount of damage, and you can do that without having to do the physical impact of attacking IT. And then again, foundations of the internet, the fact that Sea Turtle is attacking DNS, there's some serious concern about the things that nation states, they almost feel empowered and a little bit brazen in the things that they're doing. And as time goes on, there's some serious concern that intentionally or otherwise, they could really affect the foundations of the internet and cause really, really widespread problems. With that, I'm gonna hand it over to my colleague, Pierre, to talk a bit more about what he's seen in the field.
Thanks. It's always DNS, isn't it? That seems to be the case. It sounds pretty bad, doesn't it? There's a lot of really good information that Nick just shared that gives you an idea of the landscape we're dealing with as responders and defenders of environments. And I'm gonna go over some of the lessons that we've learned as part of the incident response team over at Talos and give you some idea about the things that we've identified as controls that can be leveraged to respond to these sorts of incidents and prepare yourself for the next thing down the road that we don't know about yet. Talking about some of the essential controls and basics that we'd encourage you to consider when we're talking about preparing for an incident. We've identified a number of controls that are applicable to most of these incidents that Nick just reviewed. Things like MFA, centralized logging, limiting Windows tools to trusted accounts. We've seen a number of times where adversaries have used built-in tools to move around the environment, not pulling down their own malware, but leveraging tools like WMI, PSExec, PowerShell, et cetera, to move around and to execute their operations. Doing network segmentation, protecting those systems that can't be defended otherwise from the rest of the environment so that you don't have a very vulnerable environment that's going to be exposed to adversary attacks potentially. And also isolating the systems of most value away from the systems that are most likely to be compromised. Patching or remediating vulnerable systems and software. And this is something that everybody says and few people do well. And it's something that, especially for systems that are most critical, you need to really consider this. And we had the opportunity to validate a lot of our controls and recommendations against the information that was leaked by the Conti ransomware playbook that was in August of 2021. And we were able to look through and see that the adversary was doing pretty much exactly what we thought they were. And the countermeasures and detections that we had in place were effective. So it was a nice validation of the approaches we had. But it's a good reminder that adversaries often use a playbook that's pretty specific. So I'm going to talk a little more about creating a defender-friendly infrastructure. And what that means is developing your environment to make your incident response as easy as possible, taking away the friction points that we often run into as defenders when we're dealing with trying to respond to an incident. We often run into a situation where we don't know the assets or the relations between these assets or the systems involved. So we have a situation where we're asked to defend an environment that we may not have the full architectural understanding of. We definitely encourage you to look into what your assets are, the interrelationship between them with regard to authentication, to interplay between data structures, et cetera, what the risks are with regard to these, which ones are considered to be critical for your environment, which ones are the executives gonna call you about when they go down, which ones are they gonna say, did they get to this server or that server? Know where your PII and PHI are stored, et cetera. Where are your blind spots? You're always gonna have situations where you can't do logging on a system for whatever reason. Is there a good reason for that? It's something you can then rectify. And then more about logs, do you have a place where your logs are retained? Do you know how to access those? And do you have a way of getting into those reliably? We've often run into situations during incidents where we have a customer's calling us in a panic because they're dealing with an incident, and they say, oh yeah, we've got years of firewall logs, but only Fred can get to those, and Fred's on vacation in the Bahamas, and he won't be back till next week, Tuesday, and everything hinges on these firewall logs. So having a good plan for how to access your logs is critical for making your environment more friendly to actually defending it. Also consider how to deploy your tools that you need to deploy. Do you use a software deployment system? Is that gonna be down possibly? Do you have a backup plan for how to deploy tools? What kind of tools will you deploy, and how do you back those out, and what's the impact on the systems? There are definitely some things that you don't want to touch from a standpoint of, in the middle of an incident, you don't want to go installing tools on systems that are already misbehaving if you don't know what the impact is. So understanding what the impact is, what the behavior is, and knowing the again, the alignment between business and defense, and understanding how your defensive activities are going to impact the business is critical. I'm going to walk through some of the phases of the incident response process and talk to each of these phases about some of the suggestions. So starting off with preparation, understanding what questions you need to answer. This is a key part of my theme when I talk to some of my customers and some of my team members about how to develop your approach for your methodology for investigations. It's not always about the tools or data you have, it's about the questions you're asked. If you are in a position as a defender or as an incident responder, and you have an executive asking you, did the malware execute? That's something that we can usually figure out from a log. Did they get data from a system? How much data was transferred? Where was the data transferred to? These are all things we can map back to specific data sets. But if you don't have access to those data sets because you didn't think about that question, then you're not going to be in a situation where you can answer those questions. So consider what questions you're going to be asked, and maybe this is a good opportunity to have a discussion with your leadership ahead of time or whoever you're doing defending for to find out what kind of expectations they have. Do you want me to be able to say where this person went to for the past 30 days, 60 days, 2 years? And that then guides you in your retention of your logs. And then it also gives you an idea and sets expectations with the people you're working for about what you can and can't do. So they're not going to come to you with a question for 5 years ago, did this thing happen, when they know very well that your logs are only kept for 60 days. Plan for access to preserve and analyze your evidence. So making sure that you have access to your logs. Again, the whole idea of making sure that you know where logs are, you can access them, you can do whatever is necessary to correlate them and move them around. This does become a problem often during incident response. Once you know that, then test and practice it. Go through processes where you do exercises to validate the logs, make sure they're running correctly, make sure you can extract them, and go through some internal testing on that. And then update your processes for containment as necessary. As you find new methods of attack that adversaries are using, think about different ways of containing them. We'll talk more about that as we get into the containment section. I'm talking about detection analysis. Plan for comprehensive monitoring. Once you have IOCs and things that you've seen adversary do, techniques, tactics, et cetera, make sure you know how to detect those in the event that they're occurring. This will, again, help you with defending your environment through your incident you're dealing with, and knowing how to do this monitoring is really crucial for being sure that your containment's actually working. And then have a triage process and understand how to execute it, what the impact is of the triage process, and then how to use that data. One of the other things from an administrative perspective we run into often is what the declaration of an incident actually means for an environment. And this depends on the environment. There's often a lot of administrative processes that get delayed when we're going through an incident, where we have a situation where maybe some change management processes are canceled because we were doing an emergency incident. Maybe there's other funding that becomes necessary or available, or other types of protocols that go into place. So it's important to identify who would be doing the actual declaration of incident, what role would be doing that, and then what the process is for communicating to those stakeholders about a potential incident, making sure that you track that accordingly. On containment, it's again, goes back to understanding your environment, know what good is, know what normal is, and then being able to understand how to contain those things. And think about what the impact is of the containment activity you do. I remember an incident that I responded to a couple years ago that was at a hospital. And we wanted to isolate that building because we saw a malware outbreak that was likely going towards pre-ransomware. When we were talking to the team about how to do the isolation, we wanted to basically cut off the whole network there. And we talked it through with the customer a little more and figured out that the right thing to do was to block SMB traffic because that's what was being used by the adversary to move around. When we did that, that was able to stop the adversary activity and was able to leave all the things that were running that kept like dialysis machines and other life-saving machines and stuff up and running. If we had done a complete network shutdown, we would have impacted those, and there would have been possibly actual, you know, human consequences. So it's important to work with your teams to think about maybe your primary method for containment and then backup methods for containment. Not all containment methods are going to work for all incidents. And then also consider using automated containment methods. There are definitely tools that have good automated capabilities for doing containment of systems. But you want to be really, really careful about only using high fidelity alerts for this. Otherwise, you create a situation where you're going to possibly denial of service yourself. And you have a situation where you may cause outages of your own environment unintentionally. know how to back those out and make sure that there's somebody tasked with monitoring those in case something goes wrong. Password resets are a necessary evil, unfortunately, when we're dealing with Active Directory compromises. This is what the adversary uses to move around the environment. They'll gather credentials from a system and then move laterally, gather more credentials, escalate privileges, and then they've got, you know, potentially domain admin. And they'll continue running through the cycle a number of times. The only way of removing the adversary from the environment is to do a comprehensive password reset, including service accounts. And then, you know, there's definitely needs of coordination with regard to timing. It's not an easy process. And if you haven't done it in a large environment, you should probably consider how you would do that and how you would test it. Because it's not something that can just be done at the drop of a hat very easily. So knowing that this is likely going to be your future, if you have an Active Directory environment, you should at least have an approach that you're ready for. And then determine what the backout plan is for removing a device from containment. What will make this device clear or acceptable to be put back in the environment? Are there specific criteria you're looking for? Behavior, reinstallation, configuration changes? And this is going to be dependent upon the incident you're dealing with and the tools and methodologies the adversary is using. Things you need to change. Maybe it requires a full rebuild. Every instance can be a little bit different. And along with that, make sure that those controls and recommendations that you've created over your investigation have them implemented into the new systems as you're rebuilding them. We talked about the eradication steps already. So think about the threshold for rebuilding systems. Sometimes the data on a system will be valid and recoverable, but the operating system is questionable, where the adversary may have had time to deploy tools or make changes to the operating system, and you can't recover the OS, but maybe you can recover the data. So knowing how to be more specific about the data you're pulling off of a box that's compromised, and then doing some sort of validation and putting it onto a new clean box is gonna be a better approach than restoring the full OS backup. And then understanding how your backup infrastructure works. This is absolutely critical in the event of ransomware and pre-ransomware world that we live in. We see adversaries intentionally targeting backup infrastructure every time. This is part of their normal playbook, so we have to expect that. If you have a backup infrastructure that's linked to Active Directory or uses Active Directory service accounts or credentials, your backup environment is going to be targeted by the adversary when they compromise your environment. So you need to make sure you have a process for having offline backups, or a backup environment is segmented off or separated off from your Active Directory. So you have a way of recovering your environment and keeping it, your backups, separate from your environment. There are definitely ways of accomplishing this. There's not, you know, it's a, you know, one-all solution, but there are definitely offline backups, et cetera, that should be considered, especially for sensitive data. Every time I hear of a customer that gets encrypted with a ransomware situation and they have no backups or the backups are encrypted, you know, this comes up. So don't be in that role if you can help it. So looking at the incident at the end, in retrospective, make sure to capture the recommendations that have come up for improving your process. Always spend time doing a lessons learned debrief with your team and reviewing what went well and what didn't go well. And document any needed process improvements and then work those back into your plan. So in summary, consider the threats that you're concerned about and think about the TTPs and tactics that adversaries are using. Do you know what questions to ask? And do you have the logs or telemetry to answer these questions? The following slide has some good examples of the TTPs and different tools or methodologies or approaches for looking at data or for controlling these sort of TTPs. This will be in the slides you can get afterwards as well. And I believe, oh, actually, we've got a couple more slides here. From a standpoint of evolving the defenses, continuing to improve them, is a really, again, important part about testing and improving your environment. Going through the process of looking at if your IR plan or your process you use has all the capabilities you need to handle new kinds of incidents. A good example is Log4j. The Log4j situation, we had, that was in December of this past year, there were logs that we had in our environments that were capturing the activity that was happening for Log4j, but we didn't know what to look for. We didn't know the string to look for at the time until the information was shared. So we had the logs, but we didn't know how to instrument. So going through and making sure to map out that this log has this data means this thing is a good part of learning and improving your environment. So thinking about the right TDPs and information, making sure you capture that, make sure you're using it the right way, making sure you have the right team members. Again, sometimes there's gonna be a different team member that's required to deal with certain situations, whether it be different types of log infrastructure needed. Do you have the right people on the team to help gather data from, let's say, NetFlow data or firewall logs, et cetera? Are they in part of the incident response team or not? And then go through a process and test those your incident response plan. Do a tabletop exercise to test your response. It's better to find out during a tabletop exercise than in a live fire incident that there may be somebody who's not on the call. And then continue to look at your detections and alerts. And again, we talked about the log4j. For instance, again, if we have the log situation with log4j where we have logs being created, but we don't know how to use the logs yet, think about that. Think about new things. SolarWinds, we had a situation where we had new data or new ways of looking at data we were already collecting, but now we had the TTPs and the IOCs that the adversary was using for these sort of attacks, and we knew that this mapped directly to an attack. We were to be able to take different action based on that, based on the intel we had. So work those into your detection processes, and then look at the attack framework and attack matrix for good examples of the different types of threats to consider. And then make sure your team knows what to do when they see those alerts. Having an alert with no explanation is not very useful. If you have some opportunities to train your team on how to deal with these alerts, what needs to be done, what this indicates, maybe this indicates a connection, maybe this indicates a web shell being dropped, maybe this indicates something else. Make sure to explain that to your team so they know what actions to take further. And that's the presentation.
Yeah.
And if you have more information about Talos, you can get it here for some of these links.
I think we have about 10 minutes left, so we should have time for one or two questions. They do ask that you please use the microphone here, so if you would, please go ahead and line up, and we can get through as many as we can get through in the time we got. Yeah, go ahead.
Hey, so I track a lot of malware being hosted on legitimate services like Discord, OneDrive, Google Drive. Is that a trend you guys have been tracking, and if so, how do you see that space evolving?
Yes, it has been. So we did some research early on in the pandemic on how Discord was being heavily abused. We continue to see that today.
Yep.
The explosion of collaboration apps has really kind of increased the attack surface for that stuff. And it's honestly made it difficult for enterprises, because historically, you maybe had one tool that you had to support internally. Now you have the tools you want to support internally and all the external connections. So now you have to support 2, 3, 4 different messaging apps. Adversaries are definitely following it. The biggest thing that I see is if you don't need that particular messaging app, make active steps to block it so that you don't have to worry about an adversary leveraging it in some way to do something malicious.
Yeah, that goes back to the same no normal and make sure to isolate things that are not normal.
Yep.
Do you think silent patching has become a problem?
Silent patching from the adversaries or from the?
Oh, from the vendors.
So that could be an issue. It's difficult because as an enterprise, as someone who's lived on both sides of security and non-security in the enterprise, patching is super important, but you need to be able to test, because the last thing you want to have happen is have a patch get applied without you realizing it and have it break some critical service. So there is some challenges. Obviously, getting patching done in a timely manner is super important, but making sure that you test it, that you have the ability to test it, is going to be very important.
There's a balance for sure, and there's definitely going to need to be mitigations in the short term during your QA test process. Yep.
All right. Any more
additional
questions?
Okay.
All right.
Well, thank you all
so
very
much.
Have a great day.